Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another episode of FitzRupee Cast, featuring DoW2, the elite mod. Red-Rupee here, calling the shots for you tonight as always. Only tonight, I'm not alone. We're doing a co-cast tonight, and I have with me Mr. Cyrus. Say hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the cast. Now, Cyrus is someone you may recognize the name, actually, if you've been following me for a while. If you go way back.
I know what you're
going to I actually have a series of videos before I was even allowed to post videos longer than 10 minutes. Games were split into 2 and 3 parts because I didn't have enough subscribers or followers or whatever, because that's how YouTube used to work. I'm not sure if it does that anymore, but episode 10, I think, it was my last one. I did 10 episodes before I posted anywhere, was me versus Cyrus, and it was a Space Marine mirror with dreadnoughts and all kinds of crazy stuff. I think on quests, right?
Yeah, that was APO TM, I think, right? I think it ended with me getting like a really bullshit dread kill or something like that, because you had me on the ropes. I remember, this is funny, this is pretty much how we met, isn't it?
I think so, because I'd seen your name around. I feel like I remember you initially, like I remember the first few times I played Cyrus, I think you were playing like Scout Snipers and it was enraging.
This is like 2-3 years ago or something?
Oh yeah, this was probably right around the start of Retribution.
Yeah. We played this match, and I remember afterwards you saying something like, oh, I'm going to be casting or something like that. And then, like, I saw it on YouTube. I'm like, hey, no way. I remember that. That was tons of fun.
Yeah, that was really cool, man. Cyrus is also one of the few people I've actually met in real life from the DoW2 community. Up at PAX, East, we always hang out for a little bit if we can. You're always busy, as am I.
That is true. But, you know. We are both in the games industry.
Yeah, we
PAX
have
PAX
some
is like our
do.
Trade show.
It's work/play,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
But you've got game stuff going on. I normally have MAGFest stuff going on. But anyways, before we ramble on too much,
all right, so
let's talk about some DoW2, huh?
On that note, I've been playing random for a while, but I've switched to maining GK once 2-3 beta or whatever came out.
Right.
Because I've been like, hey, you know what? I have never mained them, or I'd mained them a while ago, so I want to try them out. They have a whole bunch of new units and new combos and stuff like that, so I've been playing a bunch of matches and actually getting some good tips from shout-out to Crewfinity and Forest Radio, who both been giving bouncing tactics back and forth, and I've been getting better and better. So
yeah, awesome. That's why I wanted to bring you on, because I myself am not familiar with Grey Knights very much. Either viewers can tell from my cast or anyone that's played with me playing against GK. It's pretty notable, noticeable rather. That
and the best way to know how to counter any particular race or in anything in any game I've always found is play them for a little while, try out the things you think are super OP, and see how other people counter them. And it's the best way to go.
Good words to live by. Anyways, we're at 5 seconds. If you're ready to go, I'll count us down and we'll get this rolling. All right, and 3, 2, 1, resume. And we're at 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yep, like
all
one
right,
second.
Awesome. So we've got you as Grey Knights on the red side. We've got PhatE as the War Boss, Orc War Boss. So how's the War Boss Grey Knight matchup?
War Boss is probably my third worst matchup behind Chaos Lord and Hive Tyrant. It's basically those big tanky single entity commanders. My single target DPS not so great.
Okay, so you just don't have a lot of good burst down options. I would feel like with the strike squads and the Inquisitorial Stormtroopers, the ISTs, it wouldn't be that difficult to kind of gather up and focus down a hero like that.
The problem is that the amount of damage they do isn't quite as high as it needs to be.
Okay.
At least if the big tanky hero is coming in with the rest of his army. If he's just going in by himself, sure, you're gonna split and destroy him. Mm-hmm. But if it's a smart player and he's using it as a spearhead, which PhatE is a good player and he's gonna do that, it takes a while to put down. And especially if it's unsuppressible, Purgation Squad isn't gonna help you.
Gotcha.
Thankfully, War Boss is somebody it will work on. By the way, this is the third match that PhatE and I played with each other. He whooped me good the first two, so I just want to point that out.
All right, so you go with the double IST. Is that always pretty much standard? That's always what you start with.
Yeah, you need. I mean, they're a lot like SM. You really need those two scouts in a one-on-one.
sure, just at least for map control, if nothing else.
Yeah, I'm gonna use them almost primarily as cappers all map long. They're damage.
Yeah, I mean, I guess against big shooters and stuff like that, they're just gonna melt.
Yeah, that's the thing. In the beginning of the match, no problem. But once you get the big shooters and the knob up there, they're not. They can't show their faces. They need to stick in the back line, doing support, doing capping.
All right, cool. So you're pushing into the middle of the map. You got those shooter boys down. Are you just looking to pressure some power early at this point?
At this point, I've got double cap going on, and I've got my BC and my strikes grouped up, and they're looking to pick a fight.
Cool.
Because with that pair together, with the charge, we are the hammer, you can get out of a bad situation or force a fight. So I'm just looking to pick a fight. We'll see what happens. I noticed his war boss capping up in the top left.
Right, so
I'm like, fine.
You
don't want to have your war boss with the rest of your orcs? I'll bleed models.
Sure. You just recognize that the big tank, your only real problem in the matchup, is not going to be with the rest of this army.
Yeah, or at least in tier 1, or early tier 1.
Sure.
So here we go. Here's the big you are the hammer pop. And
get
we'll
the nice knockback on those sluggas.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that special was the luck special, not gonna lie. But I got it, so I win the fight. Meanwhile, I'm building Purgation right now.
Yeah, you got Purgation coming up on the back line. You don't normally stress your gens too early. You don't need that extra power at the beginning.
I only like doing a forward node and a back node. That's it. I need to field guys. Very important.
Gotcha. Brother Captain getting perilously though. Okay, you can retreat in there.
start the Aegis on him.
Okay, that really gives him some strong field presence too, so he can take a little abuse and then just kind of stick around on the field indefinitely.
Yep. A big thing I'd recommend with it actually is don't build it before fights. Build it once his health gets low.
Sure.
Because it just saves your resources because you want to get that perg out ASAP. Or whatever. You know, I know Forrest swears by a third IST, but I can't micro that worth shit. I've tried triple scouts. I always lose them.
Yeah, it does. I've tried that myself. It doesn't end too well for me either.
No. In any case, I do a mass retreat there. I probably could have toyed around a little bit, but I sort of want to regroup, get my head screwed on straight, be ready for the next fight.
Sure. So instead of going for Pain Boy or anything like that, it looks like we've got Ludas on the field for FatE, and you're bringing out the Rhino.
Yeah, Rhino, super duper important and useful. I can't stress enough to new GK players, you need to do Rhino play. I don't really do the like super early Rhino. I think it might be a teensy bit overpowered, but I'm also not the best with it, so I tend to use it more as a support vehicle, and we'll see how that goes.
Was that We Are the Hammer you just popped coming out of the base just to get on?
Oh yeah, always
quicker?
Pop it on the way out of base. It'll be off cooldown by the time you get to the front lines.
Alright. Yeah, Warball's nice, coming in, getting slowed down there by the Purgation squad. But yeah, it looks like they're doing next to no damage to that guy.
Oh yeah, that's the thing. They're a shorter range setup team that does less damage, but is more mobile. So those are the kind of trade-offs and stuff that you're taking for that squad.
Right. And like you said, now that the Warboss is out here by himself, he is actually suffering.
Yeah, I'm gonna focus him down, and I'm gonna do here, watch some, you know, these are like the microcosm of the sorts of plays the Rhino's good with. You jump the Purgation back in, you back it up, you hop back out again. Fantastic.
You got a little power on your... or rather, a little pressure on your power farm coming in from those sluggers, but you got the strikes there to cover it.
Yeah.
Now, how is the Rhino particularly afraid of shooter boys at this point in the game, or are they still not really enough DPS to threaten
it? It's still not enough. The super heavy armor, which is the thing that's a little bit contentious, is just, it'll shrug off that small arm fire in tier 1. I mean, if he is like double big shooters, double knobs, yeah, maybe I'm not going in, but anything short of that. Now, tier 2 is a different story.
And it looks like he's got the Ludas there to protect, so you're not getting the free gen bash this time. Are you willing to just roll around past that?
Well, I don't know the Ludas are there yet, so it's like, alright, I'm going to burn something. Nope, guess not. Yeah, no, it was very good that he had that Luda set up there. Because I believe he saw that I had the Purgation, and then you need to make sure to defend your gen farm until you've got the vision. That's the other, I'll admit, the other advantage to Purgation over setup, which is that they're like noise marines. They could pressure a gen farm, and if you
by themselves, if you don't keep track of them as the opposing side, it's easy to lose a gen farm in the blink of an eye.
Yeah, especially if I fielded a rhino, which I have.
Right, you can choose to engage somewhere on the field, pop those perks in, get across the map really quickly, and then roll on out.
Yeah.
Strike Squad not going to stand up to the Slugga Boys with the War Balls.
No, oh, they pop user. Yeah, I'm... This is more a, like, how long can I safely stall? Nope, I gotta get out. I think I've... Yeah, I pop We Are the Hammer right there to actually give them extra speed on retreat.
Oh, gotcha.
Meanwhile, war... Okay, now here's the Orc. The Orc, I'm just gonna run down your face, and I'm falling apart, losing mid. Bleeding those Sluggas a little bit, which is nice. Retreating back with the Rhino to unload, and then fight again. So we'll see how this goes. Not so great, I don't have much left on the field.
So yeah, I feel like oftentimes people are trying to force that Rhino a bit more before they need to. But you're just keeping it in the back lines, using it strictly as kind of mobile support.
Yep. I maybe it would have been better to bring it up a little closer to get its like little 25 DPS bolter.
Sure.
But as far as I'm concerned at this point, I've lost a bit and I'm just stalling.
Right.
Now
so
we're going to see some
you're heading into tier 2. Fatty, however, went for a second Luda.
Yeah, second Luda. Yeah, let's see how that works out.
Now, looks here's, like you here's might that, lose a that... gen or two here, but it looks like you probably got it.
Yeah, I don't remember how much I lose here, but luckily I was able to. The war boss went really deep and doesn't have a whole bunch of regen yet.
Yeah, it seems like if you have the Rhino and the Stormtroopers there, you can really just kite that war boss around all day long.
Yep. But again, that's one war boss taking up what like 30 pop worth of my army.
Oh yeah, definitely. Like if
like
but,
and so
but
behind
if
that you'll
if
notice
he's not
capped.
Stalling to any. Yeah, yeah, he's definitely getting some map control out of that.
He's capped,
but that's
he
the thing, like, a lot of people that'll play that war boss or those tanky heroes sometimes will make that play but not really capitalize on the opportunity it opens up.
Yep. The purpose of shoving a big ball of hit points into your opponent's army is to stall for the rest of your team doing something. Oh, the PC!
Yeah, he got dangerously low there.
I so luckily clipped that the Luda holding the gun at the last second. Did you see that? I did.
That was a narrow escape.
Yes, it was. All right. So because of that, and because the war boss isn't on the field, I'm like, all right, I'll just mosey in and take the middle of the map now. So we're both going to be tier 2, and game's pretty close at this point.
Yeah, it's 3. I mean, literally neck and neck on victory points. But that's going to change once you put some pressure on this power farm and cap that middle for yourself. Still just keeping... it seems like you're using the strike squads for kind of a lot more capping and keeping an eye on the power than really moving it around with your force.
Yeah, as Tier 2 comes around, like, they can beat any single squad one-on-one, so I do really like them as the side capper. Until I get the... just a car on it, because that guy's abilities are pretty useful.
That allows them to grant energy to other units.
Yeah, and also they have a small snare, 50% move speed slow on a unit target. It's kind of like the toxin sacks on Termagants, but it also burns 40 energy, so it's got some interesting utility.
Okay.
Oh, but here comes the brother captain with the help.
Yeah, that Nemesis Force Harbor is a force to be reckoned with on its own. Down goes the war boss.
Yep. He got a little too cocky up there. The amount of extra damage that the Halber brought in the first engagement, he wasn't ready for. That's always that like oh no, there's a new weapon. My war boss was allowed to do anything before. Now he takes damage.
Yeah, it's funny if you can time those upgrades around an engagement. Yeah. Similar to how you see players try to time their upgrades in something like StarCraft.
Yes, timing attacks, very very important. And also, it's surprise spike damage that the enemy wasn't really calculating.
Oh man, you let those shooter boys get through.
I totally forgot about them. I wasn't paying at all attention. I'm like, burn the gen farm! They're gonna run right by. I could have killed them so easy.
And we got a truck hitting the field
was
shortly.
Was not paying attention. Oh, but I was gonna say, the BC... desperately needs one of his tier 2 weapons to keep his relevancy going.
Now I see the halberd pretty much constantly. When is the situation you would get the hammer over the halberd?
I have pretty much given up on the halberd and the four staff. I think they're overpriced and not very strong.
On the hammer and the four step?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Because it's just.
I know other people have different opinions, but that's where I'm at right now, and you know we'll see. I do try to mess around with the other ones from time to time, but if it's a really serious match, it is against FitzRupee, especially like I said, he just whooped me the last two games. Anyway, so I see the truck now, and I gotta upgrade to my Psy Cannons.
Yep, you got Psy Cannons on both the Strike Squad and the Purgation Squad at this point, so yeah. while not like a super hard vehicle counter, it at least threatens the vehicles and keeps them from running wherever they want.
Yeah, so this is one of the things that people who get surprised by GK definitely want to focus on a little bit. The Purgation Squad, when it goes up to the Psy Cannons, you have to kind of think of it as an autocannon.
Right.
And, like, you would not run transport at an autocannon.
Oh, man. It's gonna die. Yeah, we see. Yep, there it goes.
And that is... Yeah. Now, there's one thing that I think... Yep, there you go. I mean, he basically face-checked with a vehicle that has super low armor.
Right, yeah. That's not something you want to do, especially if you're not sure what's out on the field. You don't want to just hurl that truck into the... Oops! Luda's getting caught out of position here.
Oh, I get the full? Yeah, nice.
So you've got a Dreadnought coming onto the field. Was that in reaction to anything in particular, or you just felt like, I have the advantage right now, I'm going to push that further in Tier 2 with the Dreadnought?
First of all, I grabbed the Heavy Bolter on the Rhino to just keep leading Orc models and to help focus down the War Boss. The Dreadnought, I could have gone tier 3, but... Team games are a different story, but in one-on-ones, I would really recommend against going Tier 3 as GK, unless you are in an incredibly dominant position.
Okay, and why is that? Just because your Terminators cost... aren't going to bring anything extra to the field, or...?
It's the amount of cost you're going to have to apply in order to get those Terminators going. The Grey Knights are a very upkeep-heavy army. They have a decent number of units that have above-average upkeep. For their population. So I find that I am low on rec. And Terminators, unlike your Mr. Predator, for 450 rec, Terminators are all 650. That
right,
is a
so
boatload.
If you're going into Tier 3, you have to keep in mind that you're going to have a large, large amount of resources on top of going to Tier 3.
Yep. And it means I'm also not fielding anything for a while, so I'm giving him an opportunity to get back in.
Here comes the Beamy Luda.
Oh yeah, he's gonna make short work of that Rhino. And good night. Yep, there you go. Alright, so now I'm like, ugh. Well, I'm really glad I picked up that Dread. teleporter on the PC, going and tying it up. But Slugga's... Rah, 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 rah. Does he go down? Oh, I don't remember.
Yeah, the Brother Captain goes down here, looks like, and...
Oh, there he goes!
He went for the Dreadnought Claw. Is that just to deal with the bigger Orc late game that you're expecting to have to deal with, since you didn't go with a ranged weapon?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I'm nervous knobs are going to come out. And to be honest, even though Warboss with his hammer beats the Dread one-on-one, I need him to have multiple targets that he has to deal with. So.
Yeah, a lot of people will often... argue, like, why would you get a Dreadnought against Power Claw or something like that, and I agree with that. You want to present as many threats as you can force the enemy to make a decision.
Yeah, I want him punching the Dread while the Brother Captain is chopping him up with the Halberd, and there's a, you know, Psy Cannon, you know, drilling him down.
Right, right.
If it's just him versus the Dread, yeah, he's gonna beat it, but... In the meantime, I make sure to try to throw the Dread at the enemy, like, you know, fragile infantry. But, you know, depends how the fight goes.
Right. I mean, the only real threats he has are to the Dreadnought, anyways, are the Warboss himself and that Beamy Luda gun. And it shouldn't be difficult for you to tie up that Beamy Luda.
Yes. Especially with the teleporter on the captain now. By this point, I'm definitely pulling ahead. I got a couple of a good bleed on him going. Drop the Warboss. So let's see how he responds. Oh, at this point, I could have gone tier 3, but I felt that just fielding more squads was just going to work out for the best.
Right, exactly. Like you said, you feel the advantage. Like, even though you have a slight advantage, there's no point in going tier 3. If you figure the time to upgrade tier 3, then the time to build up the resources and then purchase Terminators.
Yep.
It's a very long investment and huge resource investment before you're actually going to see any benefit from that tier 3.
Yeah. And actually, the choice of Purgation was really specific in this spot. Purgation are actually one of those squads that have above average upkeep cost.
Okay.
Most units have like 2.5 rec per second per population of a unit. So if it's above or below that, then you know if you're getting a discount or you're charged.
Okay.
Purgation are on the expensive side. I think they're like 3.1 or something like that. So I used to do double Purgation squad because I really thought it was a lot of fun. But man, am I out of resources in tier 2. So
sure,
that's why
so
I went...
getting one, maybe a second one around late game or so.
Yep.
Because
at this point, I'm planning on just hanging out in tier 2 and trying to just win. So I want to just shove a Purgation down his throat and see if I can finish it off.
Right, those dual psi cannons.
Oh, they shred.
Purgations just rip apart orc infantry, yep. I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. No, it's like when you play Chaos and you go for the double corn auto cannons.
Sure.
Oh man, when you layer those together, things and the range is, you know, almost probably 30% longer than psi cannons. Psi cannons have the same range only while they're using their activatable ability.
Right.
So that's an important thing to remember while playing against them.
So yeah, it's something to consider is that once you get in range, when you retreat, you might have to fall back further.
Yeah. Yep.
Because you can use that activatable ability to increase their range and probably pick off a vehicle that someone may have overextended.
Yeah, one of the things that I think is a bit unfortunate about the gun is just that it fires its whole burst even if it gets the first shot.
Yeah, so I've noticed that. Autocannons do the same thing. If they get that initial shot off, they'll finish the volley no matter what.
Yeah, and their volleys are big. If anything were... poor war boss.
He just teleported right into the middle of his face.
Yup, and instantly.
Oh, and then here comes a Hell Fury strike. Oh, this is brutal.
Yeah.
He's got himself a Death Dread. Do you think. That seems like a weird choice at this point, but I guess he just didn't have the resource for much else. Is a Death Dread normally problematic for you if it were to come a bit earlier?
Death Dreads are an amazing purchase as soon as you go tier 2 as orcs.
The
problem is here, I don't think he even saw my second Purgation squad by the time he fielded this.
Right.
But I'm like, oh, a Death Dread. I'm probably just going to kill that. But it gets pretty tight.
Oh, there's the snare ability from the strike squad. So that combined with the Purgation squad, I'm sure it can be really devastating as well.
Absolutely. Now it's time for some DACA.
Dreadnought does have to fall back there. Was taking
it's
Luda there.
It is in big trouble right now. That BB gets us off one more shot and it's done.
Oh! Falling back!
Oh boy!
But the game's just about closed out now. If he doesn't take the map right now, it's just about done and he doesn't have anything on the field that can contest your infantry squads. Even if he were to have dropped that dread there, it would have been very difficult for him to take that center point at this stage in the game. Oh, and the Grot's shouting now. He's not happy.
Yep. I think he left one of his units in range stance accidentally. Oh, it was the I think it was the Death Dread.
Yeah, I think he had the Death Dread in range stance and didn't quite finish off that Dreadnought. But man.
Yeah.
So that's the game. That's some Grey Knights for you.
Yep. I had a nice chat with Fatty after that match.
How do you think he could have dealt with your setup a little better?
He had the right composition for it. Again, the big point was at about that 10-minute point where we pointed out that the score was basically even, we had comparably fielded armies.
But then he lost his war boss and his truck back to back.
I think he shoved his war boss a little bit more than he needed to a couple of times. He let me get more bleed than I should have. There were some things on the side where the heavy bolter rhino like got some bleed on some guys that were capping, and you know he didn't retreat for a couple. You know how it is. You're microing, and all of a sudden, there's some scout squad at some side point,
right,
like half dead, and you're like, God damn it. So it was it. You know, it's like anything, it's lots of little advantages that came together. I'm not sure what's composition wise. You know, the big one was that accidental truck throwaway. Face checking with that was really unfortunate.
Yeah, I feel like if he had had the mobility to really either pressure you with the sluggas or even get some nice flanks off with that truck, it would have been a lot more harrowing. Because if he could have gotten that truck in on your purgation, without having to threaten his own other squishy infantry squads, he could have been able to get that in there, tie up the purgation, and then have the war boss to slam around and open up the shooters. But since you had the initiative with that without that truck.
Yeah. The purgation squad, think of it a lot like a setup team. If you get a melee squad on top of a setup team, they're going to be super sad, and truck is great for that.
Right, exactly. Well, man, that was an interesting game. Thanks for bringing some Grey Knight insight to us. I certainly learned some things, and hopefully I'll have a little more insight myself going forward, and I'll have to try them out myself, like you said.
I've been trying to get you to play them for a while.
I know.
I'd love to share some more of my insights sometime. I'm gonna try to get my hands on some replay, a good replay where I get my butt whooped, and then talk about maybe some of the things that I should have done differently or some of the things the opponents do well. When playing against GK, my tips would definitely be focus fire dem IST. They bleed models like heretics. They're super weak, super flimsy.
Yes, definitely. It's tempting, even as Tech Marine, I always want to go for that, save up for that plasma rifle, but getting that Mastercrafted Bolter early can just shut down Stormtroopers so fast.
Yeah, you high power shot them and then do a couple basic attacks afterwards. It's like, oh, three models dropped off. That's unfortunate.
How much do those cost to reinforce?
They're normal price. So they're it's a 210 squad.
Okay.
So reinforced cost generally is half the price of the squad divided by the number of units there.
Yep.
So, maths.
So not terrible. All right.
Yeah. No, they're definitely reasonable. Again, they're a lot like heretics. They bleed really quick. You fill them back up again, and you use them as backline support. And every now and then, you run them forward to do something.
Awesome. All right. Well.
Yeah. Actually, just as a real quick, in this match, for instance, I never upgraded.
Yeah, I noticed they're both just sitting vanilla.
Yep.
Against a power armor army, you would undoubtedly get the plasma rifles, or not always?
Depends on how things are going, but I strongly consider it. The plasma rifles are cheap. They're only 15 power. They're very strong.
Yeah, and
I'm a big fan of those.
An additional ability as well. They give them that kind of
it's kind of like
grenade
the
shot.
Yeah, it's sort of like the scout's shotgun, because it's like, hey, on demand suppression.
Right.
Very, very useful. Very, very useful against the melee and stuff like that. The grenade launchers are nice. I generally get them against IG or setup teams. But the thing is, if the enemy army has something in it that needs focused fire,
then you don't
the
have
grenade
that
launchers
anymore.
Are terrible.
Gotcha.
The grenade launchers do nothing to a war boss.
Awesome. Well, all right. Well, that's it for this episode. Thanks for coming out, Cyrus. It was awesome. Now that we can actually pause and sync up games again, we can actually do some more co-casts from time to time. And I always like getting other players' insights. I'm more of just kind of get excited about the game. And when I talk to other people, I can normally squeeze out some more strategic and tactical info that I tend to oversight a bit.
Absolutely. Your enthusiasm is infectious.
All right, well, thanks for coming out, everybody. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Go try out some Grey Knights. And that'll be it from us. This is Red Rupee.
And this is Cyrus.
Catch you guys next time.